clean my table, put my laundry away, get my bag hung up. Oh God. Oh God. Just gonna put this away.
What up, my channel? Welcome to my very merry readathon vlog. Rob and I are on our way to get a Christmas tree. I know, super late, but I can't live without one. So we're doing that and we're getting gas before we run out. I just wanted to quickly update you that I'm working through the first challenge. It's to read a book set during the holidays. And for that, I am picking Landline by Rainbow Rowell. Now, I picked this book up early this morning, like around 3 a.m., and just thought I would read a couple chapters. I ended up getting halfway through the book. I have no self-control. It's basically about a couple who have marital problems. The family is going to be taking a Christmas trip. It's very important to the husband, Neil, and to their two kids, but Georgie, the wife, gets the break of a lifetime at work, and she chooses to stay behind during the holidays. Her husband takes the kids and goes on the trip anyway, and refuses to speak to her. She starts spending time at her mother's house because being alone in her house on Christmas is just too heartbreaking after 16 years of marriage. And one night she calls Neil on the landline phone that they used to speak to each other on in college, and she finds that when she picks up the receiver, it's like 1987 again, before they got married and when they were still very much in love. And she basically has to decide whether or not to marry Neil again and have kids with him, even though she knows that he will end up being unhappy in their relationship, or if she doesn't want to change anything and to let their relationship unfold the way that it does in the future. First of all, it is laugh out loud funny. It is so difficult to get me to laugh while reading. I have laughed multiple times while reading this book. It's hilarious. Next, I love how the characters are meticulously built and quirky. The book is full of dialogue, so if you don't like a lot of dialogue, this book likely won't be your thing, but I know exactly who the characters are, how they'll react, what they've done in the past, how they feel about things. I love how much detail Rainbow has put into writing all of the characters in this book, even the side and the minor characters. They all just feel really fleshed out, and the way that they're written makes the characters feel so vivid and alive to me, so it makes me enjoy the book that much more, because it's like watching a TV show as opposed to reading. And then I also love that Georgie and Neil's marriage kind of challenges the traditional heterosexual relationship makeup, because Georgie is the breadwinner and Neil is very much not your traditional heterosexual man. The last thing I'm gonna say is that this book is full of pop culture references, and some of you might know that I hate that in books, but because Georgie is a comedy writer, it makes perfect sense and it just puts you into the story that much more. So Rainbow Rowell is pretty much the only author who's been able to introduce pop culture elements into her books and not make me feel like they are completely unnecessary. She did this in Eleanor and Park, and I also felt that they added to the story and helped situate it within the 1980s. Thank you for pumping the gas. Okay, good talk. So now we're gonna go to Target to get Christmas trees, stocking stuffers, and what was the last thing? Wrapping paper. Each step brings me closer to a Christmas tree. I'm so excited, walking to a Christmas tree. Santa, I can explain everything. Adults be like, so beautiful. Oh, we got a ton of Christmas things, everything but the tree. Shout out to Rob for putting that in the trunk because I'm lazy. We have to go to a different location because even though it said online that they had the Christmas tree that we wanted, it wasn't here when we got here. So we have to drive to Woodbury, which is about 10 minutes away. It's all gonna be worth it. I'm not going home without a Christmas tree. This is gonna be like Harold and Kumar go to White Castle. It's like Jesse and Rob
go to
get Christmas trees at multiple Targets.
Do we have to get high?
Take two. So we're just gonna flash forward into my child's future real quick.
I can't wait to buy my child little white tees.
Aww. And some Air Force Ones.
Yeah, and some Marc Echo jeans.
Oh my God. So we're taking the display tree home, which means we have to remove all the ornaments and get it into a cart, and I can't reach. What? So we went to the second store. It said that they had two of the Christmas trees that I wanted. They did not. So we found a different tree, and the lady was like, okay, I'll give this one to you at a discount. It was more expensive, but she's like, I'll give it to you at a discount if you're willing to accept it. So we were like, absolutely, yeah, like this is actually a steal. So we go, we get the tree in our cart, we take it up front, and the tree was recalled, so we couldn't purchase it. So then we had to put the tree back, and she found a different one. It was, again, taller and more expensive than the last one. It was like $180 originally, but we ended up getting it for $64. And she was like, I can't give you a box because it was on the floor, so you'll just have to put it in your car. So welcome to our ratchet-ass Christmas tree. We're finally on our way home. We're gonna put up the tree, have lunch, and I will do some reading. Hopefully I will finish Landline and let you know my final thoughts on it, and then start another one because I'm in the mood to binge read. I got so many Christmassy books from the library, and my goal is to get through them all.
Great, we're gonna hang out, but you're not even gonna be there.
I'm there in spirit.
No, you're not.
I'm there in Christmas spirit.
Your mind and your spirit is gone. The only thing I have is your body, and I don't need that.
Okay, y'all, we are finally back from Target. We got a huge Christmassy haul, and we are looking for a good Christmas movie to put on, and then we will put up the tree. I did get some wrapping paper because a lot of you sent me so much from my wish list that I've decided to make an unboxing video on Christmas. So I'm going to be wrapping up all of your gifts, putting them under my Christmas tree, and then unboxing them on my channel on December 25th. We got a Star Wars stocking for Rob, a J stocking for me. Lights for the tree. This is a present for one of my good friends. I haven't gotten anything for her for Christmas yet, and she loves face masks, so. I have a nice tinsel garland. Did take home the I'm having a meltdown socks. I'm so excited to put these on. I hope that they're the right size for my wide ass feet. Raven, no! Hey! What else did I get? I got this amazing sugar cookie candle. It's my favorite Christmas candies, Ferrero Rocher. Wonderful time. And then I got some Christmas cards for myself and for my friends. My best friends. I had to buy this one for myself because it's so stinking cute. This little otter. I'm obsessed with otters. I love them so much. And then a card for my other best friend. Hashtag squad. I also got one of my friends a wet brush. She has really, really kinky curly hair, and if you have the same, you gotta get one of these. It's what I use on my hair. It is a lifesaver, and they're only like $8.99 at Target. It's tree time.
It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas everywhere you go. Take a look in 5 and 10, glistening once again, with candy canes and silver lanes aglow. It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas. Toys in every store. But the prettiest sight to see is the holly that will be on your own door. A pair of hop-along boots and a pistol that shoots is the wish of Barney and Ben. Dolls will talk and will go for a walk is the hope of Janice and Jen. And Mom and Dad can hardly wait for school to start again.
All right, now Rob and I are going to try and wrap these presents, even though we both suck at wrapping. You're probably better than me.
No. If you can cover the whole gift, you better than me.
I can never cut in a straight line, even though there's dots on this.
What? You can't just be like this. Gotta be nice and tight. You know?
Make a decision, Rob.
I'm trying to figure out the best way to do it.
It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas. Soon the bells will start.
And the thing that will make them ring is the carol that you sing right within your heart.
Sorry, I shouldn't have backhanded that high five.
No, you shouldn't have.
Just scalpel. Scotch tape. I'll cut pieces, got to say.
You're giving me anxiety. I don't like when you make demands.
Scalpel, please.
I'm struggling, hold on. You're making me nervous. Fuck!
It's
so eager.
I'm getting
We're already, while wrapping the presents, they get opened.
Let's switch.
Okay.
I don't think this is working out.
Let's switch seats too?
Yeah. Don't teach her that it's a toy.
No, I just want to compare this one's ears to her ears. Okay. Finish pile.
Why don't you do the other side and then see whose looks better?
Okay. Great, now the cat's had to work this, so there's like six holes in it already. Are you gonna say it's not supposed to go like on the other side?
That is such cheating. You can't just smooth it over the top of the present.
It's not even the top, it's the bottom. I'm standing by what I covered.
Okay, I'll put tape on your abomination. So this is my side that I taped, right? I know it looks a little rough. This is my side. This is what he did. So like...
Look, nice and smooth. Still smooth.
He taped it underneath the side of the box. That doesn't count.
But this is the bottom. No one looks at the bottom. And technically, I just gave you more present to unwrap.
Buenas tardes, BookTube. It is now the next day. After Rob and I wrapped presents, we watched Elf and pigged out on the leftovers from the pub. And then I binge read the rest of Landline by Rainbow Rowell. I could not believe how the structure of this book read so much like a romantic comedy. And then I realized that was intentional by Rainbow because Georgie is a comedy writer. Mind blown. I literally hated, I loathed Neil throughout the entirety of the book, and it wasn't until the last few chapters that I actually came to love him completely. One of the things this book has done better than any other book that I've read before is to capture that relationships don't exist in binaries. Things are not often black or white. One person isn't often right while the other's completely wrong. I loved how this book demonstrated what it's like to fall in and out of love with somebody. Like, a lot of Neil's despicable actions and behaviors were explained at the end of the book and put into true perspective. And it's like, so often we as book reviewers say that we want complex characters, but then when we're given characters that do have real problems that they need to work through, we often vilify and crucify them. So I really respect that Rainbow wrote a character who is as important to the story as Neil, but was so dislikable. Like, I wouldn't date him and I don't really like him as a person, but I understand his actions better than I did at the start of the book. And I think that his actions are more reflective of real people behavior, if that makes sense. So all in all, I'm going to be giving this book 5 stars, which completely shocks me. I honestly thought I would give this book 3 stars even when I started reading it. And I'm not giving this book 5 stars because it has like grand supreme writing or anything like that. Even though the writing is really good, I'm giving it 5 stars simply because I enjoyed it so much. Not all 5-star books need to be highly complex poetic writing and difficult writing techniques that were executed perfectly. Sometimes a 5-star book is simply a book that you enjoyed better than anything else. I am 2 challenges down, 2 challenges out of 5 completed for A Very Merry Readathon. I have started the 3rd challenge, which is to read a book that was a gift, and that is The Shadow Girl by Misty Mount. This was a gift that was given to me at the Midwest Book Fest. I'm on page 40 so far. I do like it quite a bit. It's basically about a 13-year-old girl named Zelia who comes from a big household of 7 and finds that her body is slowly disappearing. Most of her siblings and parents simply don't notice her already, but she finds that she's actually turning invisible and that she's able to enter a realm called the Shadow World, which is like a realm between the physical and the spiritual realm. So I'm going to be binge reading this. I hope to finish it today. Rob and I are going to get sushi because I've been craving our favorite sushi spot. I'm probably going to have hot sake even though it's only noon because I'm an adult. I forgot to mention my bow ties that came in from Goose Lesson. I ordered these for myself for the Christmas season. This one is Santa Claus. I'm obsessed with it. I also got this one, which is like a navy bow tie with Christmas trees. My personal favorite, a black one with striped candy canes. And then finalmente, I have this red one with evergreens. So, Rob, what juice did you get?
Turmeric glow, bitch.
What's in it?
Turmeric.
Why am I a bitch?
No, I was talking to the camera.
Oh,
I was like... You're a bitch.
You're a bitch.
Because you don't drink orange juice, pineapple juice, turmeric root, lemon, ginger. Did I say carrots?
Nope.
Carrots, bitch.
Carrots, bitch. And my juice, this is what I drink when my immune system isn't feeling the greatest, is called Green Revival. It has celery, cucumber, spinach, lime, and Himalayan sea salt. And then on top of this, I drink a power shot, which is lemon, ginger, cayenne, and honey.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it's got honey.
Bitch.
Lying ass.
It was an accidental lie. So what is that, a fib?
Oh, I guess. Men be like...
straight.
I am babysitting for the best family in the world, and we're having pizza. What is this adorable animal's name?
Patches.
Hi, Patches. Hi. Boop. Cat looks frightened and terrified. Hey, it's gonna be okay. I love you. This cat does not care about me. I'm gonna put it down. Get out of there. No! Fucking weirdo. So breakfast is cooking, and I figured I would update you on my progress in The Shadow Girl. I'm on page about 158, so I have 142 pages left of this book. It's pretty much a cross between a middle grade thriller and a middle grade young adult mystery. Even though Zelia is 13 years old and it's told from her perspective, I feel like the book reads somewhere between a young adult level and a adult level. It's definitely one of the most well-written and complexly written middle grade books I've ever read. The writing is really beautiful. I love the font that's used throughout the book, and the story's getting pretty interesting, although it does develop rather slowly. I will say that the story is a little bit narrow, like there's not much going on outside of the main plot, and I tend to prefer plots that are complex. I liked multiple different storylines going on in a book, so if you're one of those people who would rather to just focus on one plot, I think you'll really, really like this book.
Are you making bank? How many units are you pushing? How are you pushing units? How are you making bank?
It's in that you're not making sense right now.
It's not ready. What's up, y'all? Rob and I are getting ready to go get some pho for dinner. It's about 5:30 at night, and I am 100 pages left from finishing The Shadow Girl. The plot has gotten a lot more interesting and complex, which I'm really enjoying. Zelia's best friend, Tara, who's a new girl at school, has just gone missing, and Zelia's absolutely devastated and is determined to find her. There's some more conflict happening in the story as well that I'm really enjoying, so it's picking up the pace quite a bit, and it's gotten a lot better. A Very Merry Readathon ends tomorrow, which means I only have 24 hours to finish this 100 pages and to finish another book. That one I'm going to be reading is... Raven decided to hang out in the dryer, and I just let her hang out in there because she's grown, she can make her own decisions. So then I have to read the audiobook for A Boy Called Christmas by Matt Haig, narrated by Stephen Fry. I'm very excited about this. This will satisfy the requirements to read a book with illustrations and to read a book with Christmassy colors on the cover. And I know that I won't be able to see the illustrations because this is an audiobook. However, this is the first book in a series of three, and I have the other two books with me in the physical form, and I will be reading them for my next readathon, which is a Christmas readathon, and that starts the day after a Very Merry Readathon ends. Hoi! Okay, so I'm going to be doing that tonight when I get home. I have two packages to wrap. This is one of them. I have no idea what's in either of them, but they're gonna get wrapped and go under the tree. I will check in with you after I get my dinner because everything needs to stop when I'm hungry, and I'll let you know if I'm able to finish The Shadow Girl tonight. All right, y'all, it is about 11 o'clock at night, and I have just completed The Shadow Girl by Misty Mount. I'm gonna be giving this book 4 out of 5 stars. I loved the writing. However, I think that the pacing for the story could have been done better, and I think that the shadow realm, or the in-between world that Zelia gets caught up in, could have been better described and built. Overall, I would recommend this book. I think it was an extremely well-written young adult thriller, and it has heavy elements of magical realism to it as well. And since I still have a full day of reading ahead of me before this readathon wraps up, I figured I would fit in another book on top of the audiobook I'm listening to, and that book is Les Petits Princes by Antoine de Saint-Exupéry. The Little Prince film is one of my favorite movies of all times. It's easily in my top 5 favorite films, and about a year ago I got into a huge fight with my mother, the biggest fight that we've ever gotten into, and I ended up going to Barnes & Noble because that's my safe place, and I was looking for a book to really comfort me, and I picked up 2 books. This was one of them, and the other book was, let me go grab it off my bookshelf because I can't remember the name of it. I keep wanting to say All the Light We Cannot See, but I know that's not it. Oh, okay, it's because the cover is very similar to All the Light We Cannot See. It is To Capture What We Cannot Keep. And I've noticed that when I'm in a bad mood, I reach for French novels, preferably French novels that are set at the turn of the century or even a little before then. I don't know why, but I do. Maybe it's because that culture and atmosphere I was really fascinated with as a kid, and so when I'm upset, it's a good world, it's a good time for me to delve back into because it makes me feel at home, it makes me feel very comfortable. So anyway, I never ended up reading The Little Prince, even though it's one of my favorite movies, even though I quote it constantly, and many of my bookish friends have Little Prince tattoos on their bodies, and it has illustrations, so it will meet the last requirement of reading a book that has illustrations. So yeah, it's about 75 pages. I think I'm gonna blow through this by the end of the night, and I will check in with you tomorrow on my audiobook progress. Raven, you're interfering with the present wrapping progress. Ma'am?
You weren't supposed to see what I got you for Christmas.
Oh, hello. I'm sorry that this is my first update of the day. It's like 2 o'clock in the afternoon. I woke up at about 10 o'clock, had a massage at 11, and then came back home, and Rob and I made breakfast again and watched Bob's Burgers. And then I was just called in to work. So I'm heading into work right now for about 4 hours. I work super close, so it's not a big deal. I'm just gonna walk there. It's an insanely warm day. It's gotta be at least 45 degrees. So I'm extra excited about that. I will be listening to my audiobook while I'm at work. And then I will be reading The Little Prince and finishing that up tonight. So I'm very excited to give you my final thoughts. I think I'll be able to complete all of the challenges for A Very Merry Readathon by the end of the day, but we will see. This audiobook has been a little bit of a disaster because I don't usually listen to audiobooks. And when I got it requested from the library, they sent me a CD. And I thought that my library would have like a downloadable option. No. So yeah, I'm just going to be downloading it and listening to it at work. And I will see you in like 5 hours. All right, y'all, it is now 7:13 at night. I am back from work. I've completed listening to A Boy Called Christmas, narrated by Stephen Fry, written by Matt Haig. This is one of the most, if not the most, magical and remarkable audiobooks I have ever read in my entire life. I didn't know anything about the story going into it, and I'm so glad that I went in blind. It's essentially about a young boy, 11-year-old Nick, whose father calls him Christmas. And Nick and his father are extremely poor. His father is a wood chopper, and they barely have any money to make ends meet. They live in the same room, and Nick has only ever had one toy, which is a turnip that his mother carved a face on before she died. His father then embarks on a journey trying to prove the existence of elves, and through an unfortunate series of events, Nicholas decides to set off after his father because he never comes home. On his way, Nicholas meets magical creatures of all sorts, trolls, elves, pixies, and he discovers that the world is brighter and bigger than he has ever known before. But he encounters an extreme amount of danger, and the story itself is one of morality, prejudice, magic, and opportunity. One of my favorite things about this audiobook was how it explored concepts of right and wrong. I feel like it perfectly illustrated that there is a gray area between what is just and what is unjust. It also had a really great element of danger and loss. The loss and the danger that was portrayed in the book was very, very real. I feel like a lot of middle grade books are afraid to take risks. They're afraid to kill characters. They're afraid to be creepy and thrilling. And there were definitely elements of all of that in this book. Nicholas experiences true loss by the end of the book. And I also loved that it is a epic fantasy. And we get to follow Nick when he is an 11-year-old boy all the way up to when he is like in his 60s. And in case I haven't already mentioned it, but Nicholas eventually becomes Santa Claus. And I loved how Matt provided really creative explanations, explaining how Santa like got his sleigh and got his reindeer and got his red hat and how he became such a fat, jolly man. I loved watching Nick, this sweet, innocent 11-year-old character, morph into this wise, loving, jovial old man. I can't wait to read the second and the third book. I'm going to be reading them for my next readathon, which starts tomorrow. But I honestly think I might go with the audiobooks instead and then just take a peek at the illustrations because both of the books are illustrated because Stephen Fry is amazing. I can't believe I've never listened to an audiobook before by him. Like, why haven't you guys told me how cathartic and wonderful of a speaker he is? Ugh, I'm so excited. I mean, I love the movies that he's in, but I just didn't realize how excellently he reads. So now, because I still have like 6 hours before midnight, that means I can cram in another book. I'm still going to try and complete, start and finish Les Petits Princes. So I'm going to run a bath because my neck and shoulder are killing me. And I'm going to read it in the bath. And then I will update you before I go to bed and let you know my final thoughts. In case you need to know, this is 5 out of 5 stars. Okay, you should definitely read this book. I don't care what age you are, whether you have children or not. It's remarkable. It impressed the crap out of me. It's great. It's wonderful. If you liked The Girl Who Drank the Moon, I think you will really, really enjoy this. Okay, so I'm going to run my bath and I will check in with you before I go to bed. I need to put up with 2 or 3 caterpillars if I want to get to know the butterflies. Hey y'all, it is exactly 10:59 p.m. and I have just completed reading Les Petits Princes. I said before, I adore the animated film. It's one of my favorite movies of all time, and I still wasn't prepared to love this book as much as I did. It's essentially a story about a young man who crash lands in the desert and meets the little prince, who is this boy who lives on an incredibly small planet and has embarked on a journey to discover the courage to return back to his rose. His relationship with this rose is very codependent and tumultuous, and he's looking for the courage to return to her and try again. There's a lot that I can say about this little book. I'm going to go into a full review later, probably on Goodreads, but I honestly think this is the kind of book that you can read a dozen times and still be dissecting different things from it. I feel like the biggest themes were about loss of innocence, the stifling of child creativity, and self-exploration. Also, like, the quotes in this book were so good. The writing was extremely elegant, but it's also very poetic and metaphorical. Most of the sentences in the book are establishing various metaphors or symbols. The last thing I'm gonna say about this book, which yes, I'm giving 5 out of 5 stars, is that the writer, Antoine de Saint-Exupéry, had the same exact fate befallen to him as one of the characters in this book. And I'm not going to spoil it or say what, but actually extremely creepy that the way that he ended up dying is eerily similar to something that happens within the books. And with that, I'm going to put on the animated film, The Little Prince, and get into bed. If you haven't seen the movie, you need to watch it right now. If you enjoyed this vlog, I will have two more reading vlogs coming up within the next week or so. So definitely tune into those. Thank you so much for watching. Please like this video and subscribe if you haven't already. I would absolutely love it if you did. Stay sharp. I will see you in my next one. Oh,